Bruh. I was supposed to go to the Upper Belvedere with class, but instead I accidentally got the Lower Belvedere ticket instead, so now I have to wait in line and hope to God that I somehow get the right ticket, because I'm so dumb like that. This is a certified bra moment. Look at me. I'm so triggered.
I'm triggered. I'm so triggered. Gonna get canceled at the waiter. Can I see your manager?
I'm holding it in. Holding it in. Where's the ticket? Where's the ticket? Where's the ticket? I'm screaming internally. Where's my ticket? Where's the right ticket? I'm so mad I got the wrong ticket! Wow, moment. Okay, can I get the right ticket this time? Where's the ticket? I'm so angry that reality is being bent and warped. Bruh.
Please! I'm just a poor little boy! I'm gonna get the right ticket so I can go to class. Please!
Please! I don't want to go Karen. Please don't go Karen. It's okay. They're employees. Don't need to harass them. Don't let the anger take over. Don't let the anger take over. You're not the Karen. You don't need to see the manager. Because things go mildly wrong. There are worse things in this world than getting the wrong ticket. It's okay. It happens to everyone. Everyone has some moments of the stupid. Everyone has some moments of the stupid. There's no need to get angry. No need to get angry. Calm down. Just calm down. That's right, Richard. Calm down. No, no.
What are you doing? Are you on my dog?
Come on, calm down.
I'm so mad I got the wrong ticket.
I'm such a normie.
The dining room used to be dominated by elaborate grotesque ornaments on the walls and ceiling, with its central stucco relief showing Apollo and Diana banishing mythical creatures called harpies. Three animal paintings served as overdoors, with two of which have recently been returned to their original position. The door to the survey back right. The back right was later walled up. Solomon Kleiner's view is devoid of furniture. Instead, the eyes drawn to the room's elaborate decoration. Only figures breathe some life into the scene. The painter has set aside his brush and palette in exchange for a snuff box as he enjoys a moment of leisure. Christian Sebold created self-portraits in relaxed poses and portrayals capturing individual traits. The two smaller portraits depicting a young girl and boy in a hat possibly show the artist's children. They are characterized by subtle shadows and delicately nuanced flesh tones. The boy's shirt and hat are whimsically crumpled, the girl's hair and ribbon dress seemed to dance in undulating folds. Such portrayals conceived as companion pieces were also very popular in court. Oh.
You know where everyone else went? In that room?
Yeah.
The next room?
All right. Toward the end of his life, between 1771 and 1783, the sculptor Franz Xaver Messerschmidt explored the range of human emotions and states in a body of work comprising some 60 portrait busts that are as compelling as they are mysterious. At first glance, his character heads are realistic sculptures. The facial expressions of some of these lead and alabaster male heads seem to us strangely familiar. When working on these objects, Messerschmidt's close attention to his own reflection probably played an important role. Some of the faces, however, are overtly altered and distorted to the point of the grotesque. The artist's motivation behind creating depictions so utterly unusual for this period has never been entirely clarified, but one thing is certain, Messerschmidt's work is unique in the late Baroque period.
Canonical grimaces of Albany, and then decided to execute them in to a river. Of course, they recovered the majority.
Napoleon at St. Bernard Pass, 1801, painted by Jacques Louis David. In this aggrandizing propaganda image, Jacques Louis David depicts Napoleon as a mighty warrior leading the French troops across the St. Bernard Pass in May 1800. The campaign aimed to reconquer Piedmont and Lombardy, a goal achieved when the French army was victorious at the Battle of Marengo. There are four versions of this work. This particular painting was intended for Milan. As part of the heroic presentation of the general, the artist replaced Napoleon's mount, a mule, with a rearing horse. Marching onward beneath the steed's hooves are Napoleon's soldiers. Names carved into the rocks show the French ruler as following in the footsteps of Hannibal and Charlemagne. It is not known why August von Pettenkofen accompanied the Austrian army as a war artist in the Hungarian War of Independence in 1948-49, but this military conflict preoccupied the artist as a subject through the 1860s. His paintings do not represent Austrian and Russian soldiers in heroic poses, however, but capture the daily privations and horrors of war using a dark palette. The genre-like depiction of bivouacking Russian soldiers is still entirely in the tradition of Biedermeier realism. By contrast, transportation of wounded soldiers to and after the battle appear harsh and austere.
Holy cow, this tiny little fun-sized French guy is running rings around us.
Hey! I'm average height for the time, you jerk!
Ben, okay everyone, what the hell is going on? This Corsican guy showed up out of nowhere, and he's kicking our ass! He's exporting the ideas of the French Revolution wherever he goes, and he just declared himself King of Italy and Emperor. He can't do that! I'm the Emperor! Oh, hey fellow monarchs, I see you're having a monarch party. My invite must have got lost in the mail. I'll just set up a spot right here. Wow. You don't belong here, Napoleon. We're coming to take you down. I'd like to see you try. Whoa, I'm so scared I just pooed my pants. Hey, everyone, I just pooed my pants. No, but I did just poo my pants. Okay, it looks like the French are coming for us. But check this out. I've got an amazing idea. When they approach, we run. Away. Sir, we can't have a you're a genius. The Russian rhetoric, he's established a confederation in our turf, and he told us he'd give us Hanover, but then offered it to the British. You have to declare war on him. What is it with you and war? What is it with you and being a cupcake? Go to war!
Okay.
All right! We're here with the royal family of Spain. So, Fernando, you've been accused of plotting against your father and vying for the Spanish throne. What do you have to say for yourself? Well, Napoleon,
That's great.
Well, I've got the test results right here. Fernando, in the case of the Spanish throne, you are not the king. And Carlos, you are also not the king. I'm the king!
Meta selfie.
There is no immortality, he said, but the memory that is left in the minds of men. And in that sense, Napoleon knew he would live on forever. Oh, and to reiterate, he was definitely average height for the time.
party. And he was approached by the Spanish king in 1805 to paint a portrait of Napoleon to commemorate Napoleon's successful siege of Genoa. And that siege involved Napoleon, quite surprisingly, but remarkably, moving the French troops up over the Supermar Pass, this really treacherous Alpine pass, into Lombardy, and surprising the German army. There have only been two other military figures in history who have been able to pass the St. Bernard Pass and surprise their adversaries on the battlefield. Can you tell me who they are? Campbell, against in the Second Punic War, against the Carthaginians. So we have got a reference to Annibale, down here. Who's the other one?
Charlemagne.
In his war against the Lombards. So we got a reference from the meet that Napoleon, who has scribbled his name here, so he's done it for him, incised it in the mountainside, is kind of joining the ranks of these women court military figures from Western European history. There's also a reference here to the kind of rootedness in painting. We're moving away from something that tries to capture nature or Greek ideals or proportionalities. We're going into an area as the Romantic period. And when we talk about the Romantic period in terms of literature, in terms of painting, in terms of literature, we're talking about what tries to describe human emotions to natural phenomena. What I mean by that here is that we've got this dramatic landscape, often not ordinary people loved by the emotional painters, right? Because they're quite dramatic. But we also then have this kind of billowing cave that so suggests that the winds themselves are helping to catapult the French army and their general over the mountainside. The Romantic period also culminates in the Gothic era, where you get this kind of dark and stormy nights and there's dark castles on the mysterious and very dark woods and mountains. And these are all human emotions that we put onto.
The Imperial City of Center of Gonsonant. Trade and enterprise forged in Vienna as well. Growing industrialization brought great wealth to part of the population. This one expression in its super suitors. Interesting.
Following the fall of Napoleon, Europe was reorganized. The Congress of Vienna
of 1814 to 15 made the imperial city a political center in the continent. Trade and enterprise flourished in Vienna as well. Growing industrialization brought great wealth to the part of the population, and this found expression in a distinctive interior style. Reflecting a new confidence, the affluent bourgeoisie commissioned imposing portraits of their private salons, following the aristocratic tradition while showing off the latest fashions. At the same time, genre paintings address very different realities. They show the situations of unemployed artisans, families facing the seizure of their goods, and single mothers. Ferdinand Jorg Waldmüller strikingly drew attention to the lives of the latter in his painting, Exhausted Strength.
Oh, all good, all good. Thank you. Thank you.
scared myself.
go away. Go away, go away, go away.
Richard Kaufman. They sell portraits of Hannah, who are books that were possibly taken by the artist herself, as well as my photographers, including the architect Richard Kaufman. Interesting.
These self-portraits of Hannah Hoch are multiple exposures that were possibly taken by the artist herself as well as by photographers including the architect Richard Kaufman. The two views of Hoch from different perspectives overlap and combine to create a new image. Editing and montage, typical data artistic strategies, thus create a new assembled pictorial reality. The German Dadaist painter and montage artist Hannah Hoch, 1889 to 1978, was a key figure of the avant-garde in the 1920s. She was one of the very first artists to engage with the power of images, making her a pioneer of today's art with its critical approach to the media. As a young woman, Hannah Hoch's job with a major German magazine publisher gave her access to an abundant supply of visual material. She used this to create photo montages in which she examined tropical issues of her day. Hannah practiced and perfected this technique over the course of her artistic career that spanned over 6 decades. Little known until now is that Hoch regarded photo montage as closely related to film. On the screen and on paper, new visual experiences can be conjured up through cutting, composition, and montage. In this exhibition, Hoch's intensive engagement with avant-garde film can be appreciated through juxtapositions with her work. The show includes films that Hoch had seen made by contemporaries including Laszlo Mollet-Nagy, Ferdinand Leger, Victor Egeling, and Zsigmond Vertov. But most of all, the presentation pays tribute to the work of Hannah Hoch, who helped define photo montage as a poetic art form in the age of mass media.
so much bigger than it actually is. Area.
Oh, not nice open.
Ooh,
another one.
Ooh. He's back there. What is that here? Looks nice.
crazy. So glad I got the wrong ticket.
Ich muss mich voll gefallen.